living longer, living healthier, living better than ever before. Welcome to Mountain Pacific's Healthy Living for Life, a weekly series that gives you the information, education, and expert insight you need to become an active participant in today's ever-changing healthcare climate. Here now is today's program host.
The holidays are upon us, and as more people venture out to travel to visit family or maybe just go on a vacation, our health needs to be at the forefront of our mind, both in general and related to the pandemic. Welcome to Healthy Living for Life. I'm Janet Whitmoyer, your host, and today we'll be talking to you about tips and tricks that will help you be safe and healthy during this travel season. Stay with us. Welcome back. Our first guest today is Dr. Doug Kunzweiler, the Chief Medical Officer at Mountain Pacific Quality Health. Thank you, Dr. Kunzweiler, for being with us today.
You're welcome. Happy to be here.
I want to start off with one of the most basic preventative measures that we use to try to keep from getting sick, and that's hand washing. As it relates to travel, can you tell us what people should focus on when they are washing their hands during travel times?
Well, my first bit of advice is to do it often. I tell my older patients when they're traveling, never pass up the chance to use a bathroom. And I feel the same way about hand washing. Specifically, you should certainly try and wash before eating. If you're preparing food, wash your hands before you do that. If you are traveling and you are a caregiver for another person or perhaps a child, wash your hands before and after each episode of care. Of course, wash after every time you use a bathroom. So you should be doing it maybe 6 to 8 times in a day minimum. It's not always convenient. If you don't have access to soap and water, then using a sanitizing hand gel is a good alternative, but make sure that you're using one that contains alcohol, and it should be 60% alcohol. There are other products out there, benzalkonium and a few others, but the alcohol ones have been shown to be the most effective and the safest to use. So soap and water for 20 seconds if you have it available. Otherwise, use a hand sanitizer.
Okay. And so you said hand sanitizer. Are the sanitizing wipes as effective as the gels?
Well, almost. Okay. If you use the gel, use enough to coat both hands completely wet in between your fingers, under your nails, and then rub your hands together until they air dry. With the hand wipes, it's not quite as easy to cover every surface. It's better than nothing, but the gel really is a little better, and even better yet is clean water and soap.
Okay. So we have soap and water, we have hand gels and hand wipes. Are there any other essentials that you would recommend when people are traveling?
Oh, yeah. The first thing I would recommend is do some research into where you're going, especially if it's international travel. But even if you're traveling to a different part of the country, in the United States, I'd recommend doing some research about what sort of diseases are prevalent, what do you need to watch for. It's always good to take your prescription medications, of course, with you. And I would carry them in their prescription bottles and even carry copies of your doctor's prescription on the chance that you might lose your medications. If you have significant health problems, it's good to carry some sort of a synopsis. Your primary care provider can help you prepare that lists your major medical problems and your treatments. It's good to check with the CDC to see what sorts of diseases are prevalent. If you're talking about international travel, the State Department has a nice website, and that can talk about, you know, areas where there's political unrest or where there have been epidemic outbreaks and that kind of thing.
Okay.
So that's good. Check on your vaccines. Make sure that your vaccinations are up to date, and especially for international travel, there may be special vaccines that you need depending on where you're going. Carry a mask with you, social distance, wash your hands frequently. All the things that we've been doing for COVID help protect us from GI disease and from other kinds of respiratory diseases. Don't forget that. Trying to get adequate sleep, making sure you stay hydrated, being careful about your food. Those are all other things that are important to keep us healthy when we travel.
Okay, perfect. Great advice. I want to switch gears just a little bit. A lot of people, if they're traveling either by car or by airplane, are sitting for long periods of time, and we all have heard that sitting is not good for us. So what advice would you have for people about getting up and moving about?
Yeah, you're right. It's not good for us to sit. When we sit, blood tends to pool in our legs, and it makes us prone to blood clots. So the simplest solution to prevent that is to exercise our leg muscles. It depends a little bit on the length of the trip. If you're only flying for an hour and a half or 2 hours, it's not so important. But if your flight goes much longer than that, or if you're driving a long distance, I recommend at least every hour and a half to 2 hours getting up and just standing for a few minutes, or walking even better for a minute or two. It's not all that convenient when you're driving a car, and we all, being Americans, sort of just get in the car and go until we get there. But it really is much healthier if you stop every 2 hours or so. Walk around the car, maybe stop at a rest stop and take a little walk, stop at a gas station and walk around. It helps prevent blood clots. It gets your muscles working again, prevents your joints from stiffening up. So it really is important.
Okay. Just in the last minute that we have, I wanted to go back to your comment about hydration. Mm-hmm. How do we know if we are getting enough hydration? And is there an idea that you can tell us of what we should be drinking and how much we should be drinking and how often?
Yeah, the usual advice is try to drink 6 to 8 cups of water or some other liquid like juice or tea in the course of a day. And that's 8 ounce cups. That turns out to be a lot of water. But a good way to monitor it is every 2 to 3 hours, you should be passing some either clear or slightly yellow urine. If you're not, if you're going longer than that, you're probably running on the dry side. If your urine is dark, it's probably concentrated and most likely you're on the dry side.
Okay.
But 6 to 8 8-ounce glasses of something over the course of the day is the general recommendation.
Great. This has been really wonderful advice, and we'd like to thank you. We need to take a break right now. When we come back, we know that flying for some older Americans can be difficult because they don't know about the services that are available to them. We'll talk about that and what airports and airlines are doing to help protect us from COVID-19 right after this. So stay with us. Welcome back. With us now is Shannon Wellnell, a travel agent who is here to help give us some tips and tricks on how we can stay safe while traveling by air. So first of all, thanks for being with us, Shannon.
And you're welcome.
Sure. The first question that I wanted to ask you is, traveling during COVID-19, what changes can people expect to see when they're going to the airports related to COVID restrictions and so forth?
The biggest thing at the airports is it's not a lot different, but there's far, far, far less people. That's one thing for sure. The airports are kind of empty. They've blocked off certain seating in the seating areas. They'll have either something over the seat or there'll just be a little note on the seat. So they're really trying to social distance in the airports. And the other thing you should remember is you're gonna have to wear your mask the entire time in the airport unless you're eating or drinking. So those are the two real biggest things.
Okay. So can you tell us what the airlines are doing to, and maybe the airports in additionally, to what they're doing to try to keep people safe?
The airlines are handling it really well. They're all on the same page as far as masks go. You have to wear your mask, obviously, in the airport as you're boarding the plane, the whole time on your flight, and as you're deplaning. The exceptions are you can, again, take your mask off when you're eating or drinking. They don't like you to have the masks with the vents in them. They have to be actual masks. If you have a face shield, you still have to have a mask on under your face shield. It comes in a little bit different with the social distancing on board. I know Delta and Southwest, they're continuing to block the middle seats on the aircrafts. Delta is through like mid-January. So you don't have to worry about sitting right next to someone if you book on Delta. A little bit different on American and United, they are selling every seat. So social distancing is important to you while on board the aircraft. You're gonna wanna look probably at Delta. They're doing a really good job cleaning the planes between. They're taking extra precautions, handing out wipes, doing the best they can to keep us all safe while we fly.
Okay, great. For people that have mobility issues, flying can be daunting for them just to begin with. Is there anything that you can share with us to help them with some tips of getting around the airport itself?
Be sure when you make your airline reservation, whether you use a travel agent or you do it yourself, that you note that you need a wheelchair if you have mobility issues. Even if, you know, you're just not a great walker and you can't get around quickly, maybe it's not a severe mobility issue, but just request a wheelchair. Someone will meet you right at when the plane lands, someone will meet you right on the jet bridge. They'll have a board with your name on it. You hop in the wheelchair and they take you to your next gate. It's so much easier to do that. The motorized carts that go by, you can't request those. Of course, you can use one if it's there. But always request a wheelchair if you feel, even if you might need one. Better safe than sorry.
Okay. And then I want to talk a little bit about going through the TSA checkpoints. First of all, are there some things that TSA people can do to help you or that you could ask them to do to help you get through the checkpoint any easier?
Right now, the checkpoints aren't busy, so that's nice. Okay. Obviously, since there's not a lot of people flying. But if you do have, if you have a lot of medication, if you have it in your original bottles, that's nice. That makes it easier. If you're over 70, I believe it is, you don't have to take your shoes off, so that's nice. If you can't go through a regular X-ray screen because of like metal in your body, you can let the TSA agent know that you have that issue. They might ask you for a card that shows it, but they'll probably let you through a different screening area. If something still goes off, you may end up getting a pat down, but they're just doing their job and trying to ensure we're all safe. So just the more communication you can give to the TSA agent, the better, what your needs are and what your issues are.
Okay. Now I want to ask you about bags, whether it's a check bag or a carry-on bag. For folks who have difficulty with that, are there any options to help them get those through where they need to go?
Well, right now it's a little bit unique with COVID. I think the flight attendants are going to be less likely to help you lift your bag into the overhead bin. Everyone's really nervous about touch points and things like that. So I wouldn't rely on a fellow passenger or a flight attendant to help you get maybe a bigger bag that you can't get into an overhead bin. So my recommendation during this time would probably be to check the bag. That way you don't have to worry about it on board and it'll arrive at your destination waiting for you at baggage claim.
Okay. And for older folks who are traveling, what would you suggest for them as far as what they should wear when they actually fly? Is there anything better or worse?
I have found since I've traveled a couple times now since March, and I think the airlines are colder. I think there's more air that's being moved through. They're trying to do a lot better job with ventilation and getting, you know, fresh air through the airplane. And so I always dress in layers. So I think that's very important. You can always take a layer off if you get too hot, but they don't hand out blankets or anything like that anymore. So if you're too cold, it could be a long, miserable flight. And always good, comfortable walking shoes.
Okay, those are great ideas. Are there any discounts or travel deals that are available to seniors that they might not know about that you could help them with?
You know, my biggest recommendation for that would be to talk to AARP. I mean, I personally have travel deals on my website, but they're not necessarily for older people. If they're looking for something specific with that, I would have them get in touch with AARP.
Okay, great. We're going to take a break right now. When we do come back, Shannon will be back with us to talk about traveling by road and also the wonderful cruise ship. So stay tuned. We'll be right back. Welcome back. We're still here with Shannon Wellnell, and we're going to focus now on traveling by road and by water. So Shannon, let's start off with road trips. Whether you're taking your car or RVs, which a lot of people are now are doing more and more, what should be on a checklist before they get started on those types of trips?
Be sure you have all your medication. Obviously, that can be hard to fill if you're on the road. You're going to want to take plenty of water, especially if you're going to try to avoid stopping at different, you know, convenience stores and things like that now. So in that instance, pack snacks as well so you can avoid your stops. Probably a flashlight would be something good to have in case something happens and you need that. A lot of times there's a flashlight on your phone, but if, you know, an extra flashlight wouldn't ever hurt. A first aid kit is always good. And now, because of everything that's going on, be sure you have plenty of masks. Because you will need them at different stops.
Okay, and so that brings up a really good point. We talked in the previous segment about air travel and COVID. Can you tell us what some of the other precautions other than masks are that, or things that we need to be thinking about when we're driving, such as hotels or pit stops or anything like that?
The one thing I noticed at hotels is they're not cleaning, some hotels, I shouldn't say all, but some hotels that I've been to, they're not cleaning between your stays any longer. So if like you check in on a Monday, there's not going to be a housekeeper that comes in and cleans your room in between stays before you check out. So that's just something to be aware of. You can let the front desk know if you need any extra towels or shampoos or things like that. A lot of them, when you first check in, there'll be a seal on the door that you break, letting you know that that room has been cleaned and sanitized and it's ready for your stay. But they won't come back in your room again until you check out unless you need something. Then you need to get it from the front desk. That was just something I was surprised about and wasn't aware of. I kept waiting for the housekeepers to come bring me towels and never happened.
Oh, wow. That's a good point. So what about general road safety, especially for older folks who might be traveling? What advice do you have about that?
You know, I just think just try to get your driving done during the day. You know that I don't see very well at night. So I like to get my driving done during the day. If I'm driving, you're going to want to avoid rush hour, especially if you're coming from a place like Montana, who doesn't necessarily have a lot of traffic, and you're taking a road trip, you know, down the California coast or something like that with a lot more traffic. You know, you want to avoid rush hours and get your driving done during the day.
Okay. So now I want to focus a little bit about cruises. And I know that's been really difficult.
Yeah.
You have thousands of people confined to a small space. Do you know what the cruise lines are doing as far as COVID precautions?
I know some. Hopefully we'll know more very soon. The Healthy Sail panel submitted their recommendations to the CDC on September 21st. And so they're working really closely to try their, I think was 74 touch points that they submitted to show the CDC this is how they want to move going forward to keep us all safe while we're on a cruise. One of the things they're looking at is you'll probably have to provide a negative COVID test within 72 hours of getting on the cruise ship. That's something they're looking at. Right now, cruises across the board are postponed until November 1st. Some cruise lines have extended their pause longer than that, but some are ready to go as of November 1st. The CDC did want to postpone cruising longer until the end of February, but the White House stepped in and said that, no, we need to get these guys going. Let's work together to find a plan to keep everybody safe on board. So we don't know exactly what that plan's going to look like yet, but hopefully in the next month that takes more shape. And then we'll know.
Okay, great. For someone who's never been on a cruise, what advice would you have or some tips that you might have for the first time cruisers to help them feel safe and healthy?
You know, I went on a cruise in February, kind of right when this was all starting a little bit. It wasn't anything severe yet. We didn't know how severe it was going to get, but I just took extra Lysol, the little mini cans of Lysol. I sprayed down my cruise, the touch points in my, you know, the remote, the handles, the toilet flusher, you know, all that stuff, and extra wipes to wipe down things that I thought might get a little more germy, the handrails like outside your balcony. So any kind of protective stuff that you can bring just to wipe down extra areas, that's a good way to stay safe while you're cruising.
Okay.
Always just wash your hands. There'll be someone there reminding you to wash your hands as you go into the buffet. Listen to them, wash your hands.
Okay, perfect. Do you have any insider tips as a travel agent on how to save money on cruises?
I would say book early. Right now, the cruise lines are offering some pretty good deals to try to get people back on board. I think it's important to book early. My system that I use will keep scanning your cruise for a lower rate. So if something lower does come, then we can rebook you into that lower rate. So there's no really downfall to booking early and getting deposited. In certain parts of the country, like if you lived in Florida, perhaps if you waited till the last minute, you could get on a cruise at a really good price. But for those of us up north here, what the air might cost to get down to Florida to that cruise last minute kind of eats up any savings you had. So I think it's important for us to really look ahead and book early. The cruise lines are doing really well right now. There are different programs. One is called Cruise with Confidence. So if you deposit a cruise and you can't go, you either get your deposit back or it can go to a future cruise. So if you get to the point that your cruise is coming and you're still not confident in going, you still don't feel it's safe, they're really allowing some great flexibility in those programs.
Okay. So for people that are on cruises and are interested in doing an off-ship excursion, do you have any thoughts or concerns that they should keep in mind for their safety on those types of excursions?
that was part of the 74 checkpoints that the cruise line submitted to the CDC. What they're really going to look at short term, and they don't know how long it's going to be. Is it going to be a few months? Is it going to be a year? Only time will tell with that. And this, not to, you know, quote it, but ever-changing situation. You're going to probably have to do your excursion through the cruise line, because they'll keep you in what's called, you know, your cruising bubble. So they'll keep you with those, with people that have been on the ship with you. You'll do your excursion to people that they know and are comfortable with on the island, that have perhaps quarantined before, they've been in a bubble. They're really gonna try their best to keep everyone together. The downside of that is you're not gonna be able to probably get off the ship and just wander around, because they really have to keep everybody in that bubble, for lack of a better word. So hopefully that doesn't last too long, because I know a lot of people do like to just kind of wander off and do their own thing, especially seasoned cruisers.
Okay. And in the last minute that we have here, Shannon, we talked a little bit about mobility and navigating airports earlier. What thoughts or advice do you have for people about navigating through the cruise ships and working through that situation?
So I myself am a certified with special needs at sea. So I think that's an important program to look at. Find an agent who is certified in special needs at sea, and we can really help you get anything you need to make your cruise better. We can do scooters, we can do wheelchairs, we can do hospital beds. There's really all kinds of options out there. So you should never let a mobility keep you from cruising. There's a way around it for sure.
Oh, thanks, Shannon. That's great advice and great for us to end on that note. I'd like to thank Shannon and Dr. Kunzweiler for joining us today. And until next time, stay fit, stay well, and stay healthy for life with Healthy Living for Life.
Healthy Living for Life is brought to you by Mountain Pacific Quality Health in partnership with AARP Montana. We'd love to hear from you. If you have suggestions for future programs, visit our website at mpqhf.org or call us at 406-443-4020. You can also catch us on YouTube by visiting our website and clicking on the Healthy Living for Life logo. Production facilities provided by Video Express Productions.